Thanks very much, Billy. Good afternoon, everyone. How are you doing out there? You know what? I am just thrilled that you're here, thrilled that we were able to come together in February, even though we're coming for a foreign policy briefing. I think it's just real appropriate that we're extended this invitation to HBCUs and that you responded in such a mighty way. Having you with us during Black History Month is particularly special. The history of the African-American struggle in America has brought your generation to the brink of opportunity that our ancestors could never have imagined. And the great education you are receiving at your 18 colleges and universities will only expand your choices for the future. Before I get into our program, I wanted to thank the Office of Public Liaison, led by Olive Sampson, who is the director and puts these kinds of things on all the time, and to Billy Gross, the woman that you just saw and heard from. She was the point person for this, and so I'd like you to give them a great round of applause, if you will. As President Obama has said, and as his own life exemplifies, every single one of you has something you are good at, and you have a responsibility to yourself to discover what that is. That's the opportunity an education can provide. We're hoping that some of what you discover you are good at relates to foreign affairs and diplomacy, because that's what we do under this roof and in U.S. embassies and consulates around the world. The State Department manages Americans' relations with more than 190 countries worldwide and deals in a wide range of global issues, including nuclear non-proliferation, human rights and democracy, food security, global health, international business, climate change, cultural affairs, and much, much more. We will give you a better idea of what we do through a great lineup of top State Department leaders who will speak to you today. We will also tell you about student programs and employment opportunities with the department. And we have, of course, a very special treat. Secretary of State Hillary Clinton will drop by and speak to you. She has an enormously packed schedule. So what we say in the parlance, she's going to do a drive-by. She'll be here 10, 15 minutes, probably won't take questions, but she will give you an overview of the foreign policy priorities and initiatives of this administration and of her administration here at the State Department. I wanted to just let you know that we're very thrilled to have Dr. John Wilson, Jr. here with us. He is the Executive Director of the White House Initiative on Historically Black Colleges and Universities. The mission of the White House Initiative on HBCUs is to strengthen the capacity of HBCUs to provide excellence in education. Previously, Dr. Wilson had been an associate professor of higher education at George Washington University. Please put your hands together and welcome Dr. Wilson up to us. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I want to thank Assistant Secretary Benton for her leadership and that introduction. I thank Billy Gross. Billy Gross is an exemplary Bowie State alum who was gracious enough to involve our White House HBCU initiative in your proceedings today. Of course, I thank Secretary Clinton for her wonderful leadership around the world and for the endorsement of HBCUs that is inherent in the fact that she will be with you today. I am pleased to be a part of this HBCU foreign policy briefing. Your agenda tells me that you all are in for an enriching day. But my assignment is very simple. I've been asked to use just 10 minutes to give you a sense of our common ground, to say how my office and your agenda connect. You all know by now that President Obama and Secretary Arne Duncan have challenged our nation with what we call the 2020 goal. That is, by the year 2020, we intend to have the most educated, most competitive, and diverse workforce in the world. And that means we need about 8 million more college graduates by 2020. That's the number overall, 8 million. And it also means we need about 135,000 graduates from HBCUs alone above the current base. That is, by the year 2020, we want to do our part by moving from our current base of 35,000 graduates a year to about 50,000 graduates a year. But it's not just about the number of those who graduate from HBCUs. It's also about the quality of their experiences while on campus. And that is why a day like today is so enormously important. Three quick points. First point is, there's simply no question that all Americans, that is, all American students, need a far more global experience and a far more global perspective if we are going to be truly world class. Yet, regarding student travel abroad, we lag as a nation. And as African Americans, we lag even more, and HBCUs lag still more. It is hard to be world class if you have not seen the world. So my point is, it is a national priority for us to fix this. My second point is, when we fix it, it won't be anything new. HBCUs have a long-standing tradition of producing people who have had an extraordinary impact on the formulation of our foreign affairs, especially as it relates to Africa. People like W.E.B. Du Bois and George Padmore and Kwame Nkrumah and Ralph Bunche and Patricia Roberts Harris, they were all what I call healers. They were healers, all of them. We have done it before, and we can do it again, and we must do it again. It will just take some focus and some fortitude and some finances and some friends. And that's a simple thing to pull together when you have the White House behind you. So my first point is about our distinctive need, and my second point is about our distinctive tradition in this area. And that means that my third point is very, very logical. Now, my staff and I, and when I say my staff, my associate director is here with me, Mel Hollis. Stand up, Mel. Be recognized. That's Mel Hollis. Mel is our point person in the office and liaison to the State Department. Based on these first two points I've made, we have decided to prioritize increasing HBCU participation in international programs. That's going to be a priority for our office. So to that end, our office has already partnered with ACE to develop more effective models for international programs at HBCUs. We've compiled a list of their 105 HBCUs. We've compiled a list of 40 HBCUs that have made presidential and provostial commitments to work with us to increase their participation in federal international education programs. We have convened an interagency committee, including representatives from the Education Department, State, Peace Corps, USDA, USAID, and Commerce to develop an inventory of federally supported international education programs, and we've started making matches between those opportunities and the interested at HBCUs. Now, more concretely, we are actively responding to specific expressions of interest in connecting with Haiti and Liberia and China and Brazil. In fact, the Brazilian Ministry of Education wants a closer relationship and collaboration with HBCUs, and our office is working with the State Department to prepare President Obama for his upcoming visit to Brazil. At our next national conference in September 2011, HBCU internationalization will be a dominant theme. And I say to all my State Department friends, we would like nothing better than to have Secretary Clinton to address the 105 HBCU presidents and the thousands of others who will convene at that point. The dates are September 19th and 20th, and a letter is forthcoming to Secretary Clinton. So we want your support. Let me end with this. One study said that by the year 2025, 8 million students will travel to another country for educational purpose. That's three times the number of students who travel overseas now. Peter Drucker once said that in the 21st century, there will be two kinds of people, those who think and act globally and those who are looking for work. Our goal is to ensure that HBCU students and graduates are disproportionately among those who travel abroad, who think and act globally, and who put people to work rather than just look for work. Like before and like never before, our job is to heal the world. Nothing more is required, and nothing less will do. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for your time. All right,
that's it. Thank you so much, Dr. Wilson. We're trying to move quickly because we're trying to adhere to the secretary's schedule as well. I'd like to now bring up my boss, Assistant Secretary P.J. Crowley. If you are a news junkie or if you are on C-SPAN, you see this gentleman all the time dealing with the media. So please welcome P.J.
If you see this bald head on television, you need better television. Thanks for coming. Thanks for being here. I'm breathless. I just came off the podium getting grilled for about 45 minutes by my very good friends in the news media about world events today, particularly the situation in Libya. Now, when were you born? 1989. I was about to say that what we're witnessing in the Middle East today, you have to go back to 1989 to see something of anything that is comparable. Where in 1989, the Soviet Union, in essence, imploded and ceased to exist. Everything that we had thought about the structure and organization and conduct of foreign policy since the end of World War II changed overnight. Everything changed. And we largely, 20 years later, are still sorting through, the ramifications of this. Europe is now unified and peaceful. And that is something for those of you who are history buffs, you go back, centuries, and what we've seen in Europe over the past 20 years is unprecedented. But still, what we see manifesting in the Middle East today, is the structures or the countries or the boundaries that are the monarchies or the leaders who have been in power for 20, 30, 40 years, came from a previous age. Through the independence that these countries achieved, perhaps 50 years ago. But we're still seeing some of the ripple effects of these fundamental changes working their way out, country by country, region by region. A lot of things are still, being, sorted out in Africa, for example. But this is a truly historic time. Please take a step back, judge what's happening, learn what's happening, because it has the potential to change a vital part of the world, something that's a part of the world that's vitally important, to the United States, fundamentally. We don't know where this is going, but you can recognize that truly history is being made as we speak. you know, day by day, country by country. And it is going to be fascinating to watch. I think it's important to take a step back and recognize how truly lucky we are as a nation. There are things that happen here that we take for granted that don't happen in other parts of the world. And, you know, if you watch cable television, you go, oh, God, things are going to hell in a handbasket. We need to take a step back and understand a perspective. Give you a couple of examples. We take for granted the peaceful transfer of power from one party or one interest to another, whether it's every 2 years, every 4 years. We may yell at each other on cable television. Every once in a while, the gears of government seize up. We might face that in a couple of weeks over the national budget. But even in one of the most recent crises that we had in 2000 in the presidential election, we found a way to resolve it. We shouted at each other, but it was resolved, and our political process remains the envy of the world. We can't take that for granted. We should pat ourselves in the back and do everything that we can to continue to strengthen our political system. It is something that does not happen in other parts of the world. What you're seeing in the Middle East, for example, is now all of a sudden the imposition of something else that we take for granted, term limits. today you've got the leader of Libya, who has been in power for 42 years. All of a sudden, his rule is in question. Again, we don't know how this is going to turn out, and it's not for the United States to impose a solution on Libya. But all of a sudden, you have the makings of a system where, for the first time in a long time, the people may, in Libya and elsewhere, be entitled to participate in a genuine political process where they choose governments that will be both accountable and responsive to the needs of their people. And I say that knowing that there have been times historically in this country where we've had government, but it has not been as responsive to all segments of our society. We are always in search of a perfect union, knowing that day to day, week to week, we're going to have our failures, some large, some small. But to have governments that represent all of the people, not just a narrow subset, is something that we need to value, we need to protect, and we need to strengthen. So whatever political process we have in this country, we've got to make sure it stays within boundaries so that we can continue to function as an effective society. And I say this knowing that even though you're seeing the beginnings of term limits, all of a sudden you've got governments that are turning over and transitioning. You've also got leaders who have been in power for decades saying, I'm not going to run again. This is a good thing. Now, the challenge is there's no bench in some of these countries. So, here we are just having finished a legislative election in November, and you got a range of people who are finding their way to Iowa. we've got a nonstop campaign in this country. But in other countries where there's no political process, no opposition to speak of, or the opposition's in prison, we should every once in a while take a step back and recognize how truly fortunate we are. But then you think about a country like Ivory Coast. If you have a bar of chocolate this afternoon, think of Ivory Coast, because there you have a very tense standoff between a dictator. He came to power. His term actually ended 5 years ago. He clung to power, a guy named Laurent Gbagbo. He decided to run an election. He rigged the election and still lost. And he refuses to leave. And there's a great contest going on with now President Ouattara, who is the duly elected president of Ivory Coast. But right now he's holed up in something called the Gulf Hotel, surrounded by UN forces. and we are putting as much pressure on him as we can as an international community to try to deny him the resources that allows him to pay an army that unfortunately is still loyal to the dictator Gbagbo. But again, that is something that we don't take for granted, that you have an election and all of a sudden you'll have people that respect the result. But in Western Africa, there is change going on. You go just north of Ivory Coast and you have a country like Liberia that for a long time has been a source of instability. All of a sudden now it's beginning to be a source of stability. Ellen Sirleaf Johnson, who is the president of Liberia, Harvard-trained economist, fabulous leader. She was with the secretary not long ago, and she said, you know, we've got our own challenges, but we're now offering advice to the country to her north, Guinea-Conakry, who just finally went through after an arduous time, including last year, the slaughter of a number of political activists in a soccer stadium. Liberia is now offering Guinea-Conakry advice and on how to go through these difficult transitions. And then to the south, the anchor of West Africa, Nigeria, will face a very important election coming up later this year. So you see the beginnings of political change and the development of free, fair, and legitimate political processes in many parts of the world, but they can't do it alone. In many cases, they have weak institutions, and they don't have a great lengthy history of how to do this. And that's where the United States comes in, and that's where joining with other countries around the world, we can offer this kind of advice. That's why it's important to see the emergence of new powers, including India, including Brazil. The Secretary will meet with the Foreign Minister of Brazil this afternoon, but including South Africa, that is an anchor and now can be a stabilizing force in sub-Saharan Africa. So we face a world today where two dynamics occur. One, we increasingly face global challenges, and these global challenges cannot be solved by one country alone. That, going back to 1989, that world has ended. We, the United States, may well still be the world's only superpower, but we cannot solve any significant global challenge by ourselves. But the obverse is also true. No significant global challenge can be solved without meaningful participation of the United States. And that brings me to a last point, which is to be an effective global power, we need to make sure that we are cultivating all of the sources of national power. One of them is the military. We have the finest military the world has ever seen. But that's one dimension. But if we're going to have a balanced national security strategy, where not only do we try to identify potential crises and mitigate them before they turn into conflicts, that forces us to intervene with military forces as we've done recently in Iraq and as we're doing still in Afghanistan, you need to have those kind of peace-building capabilities. We have them, but they're not free. But to have an effective, integrated national security policy, you need to have multiple dimensions of power. Military is one, civilian power is one, economic power is one, moral power is one. But in civilian power, which is what we do here in the United States, we face a conundrum. Anybody want to hazard a guess? What is the military budget this year? I'll give you, plus or minus a many billion dollars. Anybody got a guess? $100 billion? $550 billion is the military budget. Now, what is the State Department budget? Close. About 40. $550 billion? $40 billion. And the Congress wants to cut us by a few billion dollars. And what that means is that, to influence events in the, many of the countries that we are unfolding, number one, we have to be there. We have embassies in 190 countries around the world, which two are we missing? Iran, North Korea. All right. but in 190 countries, we're there. And we're there to serve our interests and to protect American citizens, just as we are as we speak. We have a ferry at a dock in Tripoli, and we are loading American citizens and taking them out of harm's way. We do that every day. But in order to be there and to have effective action and to be in places like Iraq, where our military will leave this year, but we'll still have work to do to help Iraq grow into a responsible regional power. And just as we'll begin a transition this year in Afghanistan, at some point, again, we'll turn the military mission over to diplomats and development experts. But for us to be able to shape the future of Afghanistan, which involves, among other things, pomegranates. The future to Afghanistan is pomegranates. Afghanistan 30 years ago, before a series of wars, was the primary food source of much of that region. It was the economic breadbasket, if you will. And then that agricultural economy was wiped out through the various conflicts that occurred. Now you have a situation where in Afghanistan, half of the economy is narcotics. We want to replace the narcotics with produce, pomegranates, wine, grapes, apples. But to do that, you need to have people on the ground who can help them learn to farm and farm more productively. The military can't do that. We can do that. But to do that, we need resources. So ultimately, you need to have a balanced national security strategy, and then you have balanced investments that make sure that we have the military, civilian, economic, social, and moral power to be able to help shape events around the world that are in our interest, but more importantly, they're in the interest of the people of various countries and the people of various regions. And finally, to do this, we just need to have be there and paying attention, which is why you're here. We appreciate your being here. Hope there, the secretary, I'm sure, will tell you she wants to make sure that there are lots of potential diplomats in this audience. We'll be outside the door to sign you up if you're interested. but thank you for being here. Thank you for your interest in international affairs. And because it's what I do, if anyone's got a quick question while we wait for the secretary, I'll be happy to answer them. Secretary's running 5 minutes late, so I can talk some more. But go ahead. Nope.
I just said you were running a couple minutes late.
She obviously needs no introduction. Our leader, the Secretary of State, Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Thank you so much, PJ. Welcome. Oh, my goodness. This is wonderful to see all of you. And I want to thank Assistant Secretary Crowley and the Bureau of Public Affairs for coordinating this event. I also want to thank Dr. John Wilson, Jr., Executive Director of the White House Initiative on Historically Black Colleges and Universities, for being here and for his leadership. And I'm especially pleased to welcome all of you here to the State Department during Black History Month. You are welcome anytime, but this we thought was a good excuse to get everybody together. And I know some of you have traveled a long distance to be here with us today. And your participation is very meaningful. It enriches and enlivens our activities. And boy, did you pick a good time to be here. There is so much going on. It's almost hard to keep up with. And I was looking forward to coming here to speak with you, but I was also looking forward to getting off the phone and talking to people, particularly in the Middle East, about everything that's going on. We are fully immersed in trying to determine how we can best support the aspirations of people across the region for their governments to be more open, accountable, and responsive, to make sure they have a stronger voice in the affairs of their countries and that they are treated fairly and with dignity. I did a web chat today with a wonderful young man who works for a website in Egypt. And in 2 days, they got nearly 7,000 questions for me. And they were asking a lot of them. And I had the opportunity to express our very great admiration for the young people in Egypt, for their peaceful, nonviolent demonstration. And I linked it with our own civil rights history and the role that nonviolent demonstrations and the whole ethos of nonviolence played here in the United States and then also in India. So with Dr. King and with Gandhi, those were examples of how one brings about profound transformational change without picking up a gun. And it gives a lie to the extremist narrative in the world that somehow the only way you get change is at the end of a gun barrel. So there is so much going on today, and much of it is particularly important to young people here and around the world, because it's a new future that is being born and a world that you will be taking yourselves into and leading your lives and making a living and making your contributions. But there's so much to do aside from today's headlines. People from the State Department and USAID are working to continue supporting democracy in Iraq, to help the people there realize the true results of having now a democratically elected government, working with our colleagues and counterparts in Afghanistan and Pakistan against some very tough challenges. We're using social media like Facebook and Twitter to extend the reach of diplomacy beyond governments, what we call 21st century statecraft. We're working to reduce the threat of nuclear weapons, to fight climate change, which, despite what you might hear sometime, is actually a real problem that we're having to contend with, to promote internet freedom, because that now is the venue where people assemble and they should have the same rights that we have fought for and that are enshrined in our Constitution, and so many other problems of health and hunger and just broadly across the world an agenda with a very, very comprehensive set of issues. And you will be hearing from people here in the administration on these issues, and you'll have a chance to discuss specific concerns in countries from Mexico to China, broad issues like what's happening in sub-Saharan Africa and how are we partnering to promote development and economic opportunity. One of my favorite issues, what are we doing to empower women and girls, which remains one of the best, most efficient ways of lifting up entire societies. Unfortunately, I still have to make that argument in too many places, but we are continuing to do so. And how technology can help people. We ran a contest last year with African young people who were developing applications that could spur development in their communities. And we got some unbelievably great ideas. And one of them that we chose for attention and support was how local farmers could get information about weather and what could be done to protect their crops by using their cell phones, because now cell phones are ubiquitous. 2 billion people have them. And many poor people in places that never got electricity have cell phones, thanks to wireless technology. So how do we use that as an instrument of economic empowerment, of information about health, of educational access, and so much more? So I would invite you to give us any of those ideas as well. We also are focused on energy, because one of the reasons why we believe that inequality persists in so many places in the world is because we do not have access to affordable energy in too many places. Those of you who have traveled know that you can fly over countries and see very few lights at night in our hemisphere and across the oceans because electricity hasn't gotten into villages. Well, now with solar electricity and wind electricity, we can do so much more that will revolutionize the way people can live and work. So I want to make sure that at the core of our foreign policy, we are promoting equal opportunity, something that you each have really understood and stood for, and that certainly HBCUs have played a major role in our country in working toward achieving. I often say that human talent is universal in the world, but opportunity is not. I mean, I think about all of us who were fortunate enough to be born in this country and to be given a chance to succeed. And as President Obama has said many times, though we inherit the extraordinary progress won by the tears and toil of our predecessors, we know that barriers still remain on the road to equal opportunity. So what can we do here at home, and what can we do around the world? Well, here at home, HBCUs play a vital role in overcoming those barriers. In law and medicine, in sports, literature, music, every area of human endeavor, HBCUs have paved the way for countless leaders, and our country has benefited so much. Here at the State Department, we have benefited from the talents of so many phenomenal African-American leaders. My two predecessors, for example, General Colin Powell and Secretary Condoleezza Rice, our UN Ambassador, Susan Rice, our Assistant Secretary for African Affairs, Johnny Carson, whom you will be hearing from next, who has a very distinguished diplomatic career, and so many others here at the State Department and USAID. In fact, this is really nothing new. In 1889, the abolitionist Frederick Douglass was appointed Consul General to Haiti, and later he headed the U.S. Embassy in the Dominican Republic. And after World War II, the political scientist Ralph Bunche was involved in the creation of the United Nations, and he went on to win the Nobel Peace Prize for his work on the Arab-Israeli conflict. The first African-American to be recognized with that honor, and of course, President Obama was the latest African-American to be so recognized. Hundreds, thousands of African-Americans have served in state, USAID, in our military, in other parts of our federal government, and in public service, and I would not be doing my job if I did not make a shameless pitch for you to consider following in their footsteps. We need you, and I've always believed that the best ways to inspire people to serve their country is to expose them to other cultures and countries, especially when they're young. That's why we put a particular emphasis on student exchange programs here at the State Department, programs like the 100,000 Strong Initiative, which is designed to send 100,000 Americans to study in China by 2014. And I don't know how many of you are here from Howard, but you know that Michelle Obama said at Howard just last month that when she announced the 100,000 Strong program, that when you study abroad, you make America stronger. And you also have a chance to tell the American story. It is a story about justice and pride and the pursuit of equality. And it is important to remind people who may not have any reason today to believe in any of those aspirations that something better is possible. You know, in the 20th century, people all around the world saw young African Americans of your ages stand up and speak out and claim their rights in our own country. And by doing so, they became leaders and change makers and history makers all at the same time. And in the 21st century, your generation, because of social media, because of the power to connect, have even more inherent power than your parents and grandparents did before. Because now you don't just can meet at a lunch counter, you can meet globally. And you can pursue your goals with those whom you may never meet in person, but who share your passion for justice and equality. So we are counting on you. We are counting on you to open even more doors, and we are counting on you to give us your best ideas, your talents and skills to make a difference not only here at home, but around the world. As I travel on behalf of President Obama and our country, I meet with hundreds and thousands of people every year, and lots of young people. And even though there's so much tension and contention in the world today, people still look to this country. They look to us. How did you do it? How did you maintain it? How did you overcome obstacles on behalf of African Americans or women or any other group that had not been included originally in the American dream? So I want you all to walk out of here when you finish this wonderful gathering and consider yourself ambassadors, ambassadors for the United States, ambassadors to the rest of the world. Know that the State Department, President Obama, and myself are very much in need of your presence and your diplomacy. We really are reaching out to citizen diplomats because America has a story to tell, and there's no way that you know, just a few of us can do it. We need to amplify our voices globally. And we hope when you're ready, you will consider joining our ranks. We need diplomats. We need development experts. We need people who are ready to pick up and move somewhere and learn not only about another's culture, but learn more about yourself because of the challenges and the opportunities that exist now in the State Department and USAID. I'm delighted to have this chance to welcome you and to share just a few thoughts with you. But now you're going to have a real treat because there will be so many people, and I see him sitting right there, a distinguished two-time ambassador, an intelligence expert, a development expert, a diplomat par excellence, and I'm not even the one introducing him. But someone who I rely on completely because Africa is a high priority for this president, for me, for this country. And we are looking for ways to be an even better partner in trying to unleash the potential of the people of Africa from one end of the continent to the other. So please don't be shy about sharing your ideas and suggestions. Log on to our websites, follow what we're doing, and then as you reach graduation, give us a try, because we sure can use you. Thank you all very much.
Great. Thank you so much, Secretary Clinton. For those great words, and we were thrilled to have her. And I really, okay, good, thanks, Billy. I don't think the next gentleman needs much of an introduction because the Secretary just gave him a great one. But I wanted to tell you that I was fortunate enough to tag along with him last year when he went to the AU summit in Uganda. And I thought I was gonna get like a little break. The brother worked me from sunup to sundown, day after day after day. So he's very special to me. And he's the Assistant Secretary of the Africa Bureau and a long-term, long-standing ambassador, Johnny Carson.
Good afternoon. It's very difficult to follow in the footsteps of one distinguished woman. It's even harder to follow in the footsteps of two. Thank you very much, Cheryl, for for the kind introduction. It is extraordinary always to be able to follow Secretary of State Clinton at the podium. She is an extraordinarily gifted secretary, a secretary who is committed, like all of you in this room, to Africa and to strengthening the relationship between Africa and the United States. For this administration, Africa matters, and we are deeply, deeply committed to our partnership with the continent. The history and the culture of the United States are inextricably linked from West Africa and the establishment of Liberia over 250 years ago to the White House today. No more significant and intrinsic link between the continent and America than the President of the United States. It's also a deep symbol of the level, the maturity, the sophistication of our democracy, because where else in the world would you be able to find a democratic country where one of its citizens is from a small minority of only 13% of the population, but representing some 325 million people like in this country. There are good and great democracies around the world, but I would argue that we still are the greatest. And I think the presence of our president in the White House signifies the commitment that we have as Americans to our democratic traditions and our democratic values. But our partnership with Africa is based on our mutual desire to promote democracy, good governance, and a respect for human rights, things that we care about dearly today in the United States. Our partnership with Africa is based on our desire to achieve peace and security throughout the African continent and to promote economic growth, development, and prosperity for all of Africa's people. While Africa's future is clearly up to the people of Africa, the United States will continue to play a major and significant role with its African partners in shaping the continent's future. In his speech 2 years ago in July of 2009, before the Ghanaian Parliament, President Obama pledged to elevate Africa's strategic position in U.S. foreign policy and to help ensure that Africa's voice is heard on the international stage. He pledged to work with Africans as friends and as partners in a spirit of mutual respect and accountability as we respond to the continent's many challenges and opportunities, and to the many challenges that we face together as global citizens and as global partners. We have a very clear policy focus towards Africa, a focus that we believe reflects the values of the United States as well as the aspirations of most Africans. It is based on fundamental interests in promoting democratic institutions and good governance, peace and stability, sustained economic growth across the sub-Saharan African continent. We think that these policies are fundamental to Africa's future progress and also its success. And we have defined five areas of focus for our specific policies and programs. First, we have been trying to strengthen Africa's democratic institutions to promote the rule of law and encourage good governance. Recent events in North Africa and the Middle East demonstrate what ultimately happens to governments that flout democratic principles and are not accountable to their people. Much of Africa went through its own period of upheaval in the 1990s as a wave of democratic movements brought an end to decades of military and authoritarian rule. Since then, however, progress has been uneven and sometimes subject to reversal. So much of what we do as diplomats is focused on supporting the democratic aspirations of Africa's citizens. In maturing democracies such as Ghana, we are able to focus on genuine institution building. In other countries with little democratic tradition, such as Guinea-Conakry, we must focus on more basic goals such as ensuring free, fair, and transparent elections. And still other countries such as Zimbabwe and Cote d'Ivoire, we find ourselves having to stand up to strongmen and dictators who actively attempt to subvert the will of the people and the ballot box. Second, we are promoting sustained economic growth and development, greater trade and investment, and better utilization of Africa's enormous natural resources. Africa's future success and global importance are dependent on its continued economic progress and growth. Working alongside African countries to promote and advance sustained economic development and growth is another of President Obama's priorities for the continent. The U.S. government supports the $3.5 billion Food Security Initiative to enhance Africa's ability to further develop their agricultural industries. Third, we are working with our African partners to improve Africa's public health systems, to carry on the fight against HIV and AIDS, to help prevent Africans from dying of preventable diseases, diseases such as cholera, malaria, and tuberculosis. Throughout Africa, we work side by side with African government officials and civil society to ensure that the quality treatment, prevention, and care and health are easily accessible to the many communities across the continent. Fourth, we are looking for ways to prevent, mitigate, and resolve conflicts in Africa. Conflicts destabilize states and stifles economic growth and investment, and robs young Africans of the opportunity for an education and a better life. Conflicts set back countries for generations. Although there has been a clear and noticeable reduction in the number of conflicts in Africa over the past decade, peace is still a very elusive commodity in some parts of Africa. You still hear a great deal about conflicts in the eastern part of the Congo, in Sudan, in Darfur, and in places like Somalia. Where there is conflict, the possibilities of democracy and economic growth are elusive. And fifth, we are collaborating with Africans to address a whole host of new and old transnational challenges, challenges that confront Africa equally as they confront America, Latin America, the Middle East, and Europe. These new challenges, such as climate change and narco trafficking, and old challenges like terrorism and trafficking in people, are challenges that cross international borders and can only be dealt with by the global community. As Africa faces the impact of these new transnational problems, the United States will work with leaders and governments across the continent to confront all issues of a global nature. The United States and the international community need stable and democratic partners throughout Africa to deal effectively with the complex challenges that we all face, American and Africans together, in the 21st century. Such partners are also needed for expanding opportunities for trade and investment, and thereby assuring continued global economic integration and growth. As part of our strategic objectives, we will attempt to strengthen and deepen our relationships with three key African countries: South Africa, Nigeria, and Angola, countries with whom we have established under Secretary Clinton's leadership new high-level binational commissions. Besides strengthening our bilateral relationship with these particular countries, we will continue to work very closely with all other countries across the continent, and also with the regional subgroups in various parts of Africa. The successful referendum in Sudan in early January exemplifies what can be achieved through patient and determined regional cooperation and with the help of the United States and its African partners. The Intergovernmental Authority on Development, IGAD, played a key role in brokering the comprehensive peace accord that was signed in Kenya in 2005 to end the 20-year-long conflict between North and South Sudan. Since then, IGAD countries and the African Union have exerted an enormous effort to facilitate the implementation and the success of the Southern Sudan referendum that was held between January 9 and January 15. Regional cooperation will remain vital in the coming months and years to ensure the emergence of an independent Southern Sudan as a strong and viable nation. In conclusion, I would like to reemphasize the importance that we place on developing stable and democratic partners across Africa. As much as we and other and our African partners share common goals, there remain actors who are indifferent or even opposed to them. This makes it all the more imperative that we work as closely as we can with African states. We believe this is the best approach for building Africa will and capacity to meet the daunting challenges that the continent continues to face. I hope that my comments will have provided you with a little bit of insight about the five key policy objectives which animate us in Washington with respect to the continent. And I think if Cheryl says so, I will be happy to take some questions.
Absolutely. If you could, he has time for a couple of questions. So if you go to the mic on either side, if you have a question. Thank you so much. Please give Assistant Secretary Carson a round of applause. So please identify yourself and the school.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. How's everyone? All right. Thank you, Secretary Carson and Ms. Cheryl, for having Morgan State University here today. My name is Tony Dixon. I'm a political science student and junior at Morgan. Now, you mentioned South Africa, Nigeria, and Angola. My question to you is, you're working on strengthening relationships. What outcome does the United States perceive to, what do they want to get? What is the end result?
Let me just say that I mentioned three countries, South Africa, Nigeria, and Angola, and why we are trying to strengthen our relationship with each of those countries. First of all, Nigeria is probably and arguably the most important country south of Sahara. It has a population of 150 million people, meaning it is the largest in population of all the states on the continent. One out of every five Africans on the continent is a Nigerian. More than that, Nigeria is a significant oil-producing country. Nigeria supplies currently some 8.5 to 9% of all of the crude oil coming in to the United States. In fact, on most days, Nigeria provides more oil to the United States than a country like Saudi Arabia, which you're more familiar with. But more importantly, Nigeria is the largest supplier of sweet crude, low sulfur crude, into the United States. It is also the second largest source of direct U.S. investment in Africa. There are hundreds of American oil service companies and oil companies working there to both find, produce, and export oil. Nigeria, equally for us, is a one of the amongst the 10 largest contributors of peacekeeping troops, not just in Africa, but around the world. If you go to the Israeli-Lebanon border today, you will find Nigerians among the UN peacekeepers. If you go to Cyprus today, you will find Nigerians among the peacekeepers. But equally, if you go to Darfur in Sudan, you will find Nigerian peacekeepers, as well as those who help to turn and reverse the situations in Liberia and Sierra Leone that P.J. Crowley talked about earlier. So they are very important to us. South Africa equally, and up there, right up there with Nigeria in terms of its significance. South Africa is home to more American companies and more of American investment than any other country in Africa. It ranks just above Nigeria in terms of its trading relationship with us. It is a strong democracy, has been since 1994, several years after Nelson Mandela was freed from prison. They, too, are a major regional power throughout southern Africa. And the third country I mentioned, Angola, is right behind Nigeria in terms of its oil production. It ranks second only to Nigeria in its oil production. And there again, we have major American producers and explorers and major oil service companies. A country like Angola, in many ways, is richer than both, potentially richer than both Nigeria and South Africa, in large measure because it not only has oil, it has large deposits of diamonds, it has iron ore, and it has some of the best agricultural land in Africa. And it has, in comparison to South Africa and to Nigeria, a very small population of roughly 20 million people. All of those countries are important and significant to us. We want to see these countries deepen their democratic institutions, strengthen their economies, and do this on behalf of their people. And as they do this, this helps also to strengthen the global community of which we are a part.
One more follow-up question.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. No, you can't have another. All right, thank you so much. Assistant Secretary Carson does have to scoot on, but we'll just keep the program moving, and hopefully you'll get a chance to ask questions going forward.
And the secretary is right. We need you. You see the sign? We need good black African-American diplomats. It's a great career, great opportunities. The sign says, we need you. Apply here. There's a job.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Good deal.